No doubt you've read the headlines and seen the ads on television. It's a controversy that doesn't seem to be going away anytime soon. Talking, of course, about the popular herbicide, glyphosate. A majority of the farmers we spoke with say they've been using it for years and have absolutely no health concerns whatsoever, nor have they even experienced health issues from using that product. Others, however, claim it was the source of their cancer. To date, it's estimated that 42,000 claims have been filed against the maker of glyphosate, Bayer. Lawsuits, the EPA claim, have no merit. Recently, the monitor traveled to Washington, D.C. and met with an EPA executive who shared the agency's findings about glyphosate and why they feel it's as safe as your standard table salt.
A San Francisco jury on Friday found Monsanto liable in a lawsuit filed by a man who says their product caused his cancer.
Some breaking news on a closely watched lawsuit against Monsanto.
A judge has issued a preliminary ruling that would throw out the huge jury verdict against Monsanto and lead to a retrial.
Certainly, in EPA's opinion, we have done an extensive, both human health and ecological study. And we look at hundreds of active ingredients every year here at EPA. We have many dozens of expert scientists, and they feel very confident in the information that's available on the impacts of glyphosate. So I have not heard from our career expert scientists that they have concerns with this product.
Back in April, EPA officially announced that glyphosate is not a carcinogen. Has there been pushback from that? What kind of feedback have you gotten from the American people and producers and farmers in the ag community?
Well, EPA's finding is consistent with a finding that we have made many times over. We have looked at over 2,600 studies. And again, we have a deep bench of scientific expertise here at the agency. These findings were not just made recently. They represent the culmination of over a decade of research on glyphosate. So we have a comprehensive literature survey. We have looked at more scientific studies than almost any other nation. And our finding that glyphosate is not a human carcinogen when used according to the label, used properly, is consistent with the finding of many other nations.
Can farmers and those using this find management measures that EPA suggests in the best usage and the way to use this in their fields, around water, around families, and so forth?
Well, that's a great question. So whenever EPA looks at any pesticide and how it's used out there in the environment, whether it's a homeowner or in large-scale agriculture, we always want to look at both the human health impacts and the environmental impacts. When it comes to glyphosate, again, EPA did not find that when used according to the label properly, any human health risk, particularly as a carcinogen. We did not find that. We did, however, find that glyphosate, because it is an herbicide, it will kill a weed. So, for example, when you mention water, if glyphosate is sprayed over water where it's not maybe supposed to be going, it could perhaps have effect on an aquatic plant, you know, plants in the water. So what we do propose are what we call management measures. We want to make sure that glyphosate, particularly not the homeowners, but people that are using it large scale for agriculture, are looking at wind speed, droplet size, buffer zones. We want to make sure that we're being protective of what we call off-target impacts. We want that glyphosate to go where that weed is and stay there. And there are lots of ways to do that safely.
Farm workers, landscapers, and homeowners who've been exposed to the weed killer Roundup may be at risk for non-Hodgkin's lymphoma or other cancers of the blood.
What do you say to average mom who says, I see these ads on television, they're scaring me and my family? What's the message you want from the EPA delivered to homeowners, to soccer moms, to people across America about this?
Well, once again, we stand behind our science. We're a science-driven agency. And again, all of the science behind our assessment of glyphosate is available. I'm not saying it's an easy look through 2,600 studies on our website, But we feel very confident in our finding that when used properly according to the label, glyphosate does not pose any human health risk whatsoever. We even set food tolerances, so the residues that can be left on corn, perhaps, that might be turned into a cereal product and be on someone's breakfast table. You may have heard some studies that trace elements of glyphosate have been found in cereals. But all of those trace elements are consistent with the law that is protective, and we take a very conservative approach. We're assuming a quantity of someone being exposed to that glyphosate in a way that no one would actually in real life be exposed to.
So Alex, where do we go from here? Is this a long, drawn out process? Is this battle not going away?
No, this is really an ongoing discussion that we have. And what we keep coming back to, our home base is our scientific finding and the depth of our scientific expertise. We want to try to avoid getting into the sensational stories around this chemistry and really focus again on what does our science say. And our science says that this product can be used safely, has been used safely for a long time. What we're going to be doing now is moving into the next phase of re-registering glyphosate for use. So what we put out in April of this year was our preliminary re-registration decision. You know, as I said, under the law, we take a look at these pesticides every 15 years to make sure that they're as safe as possible, because we always are getting new information. And so next spring, we'll be putting forward our final decision to re-register glyphosate.
With that being said, what should farmers do in the meantime? Are there members of Congress they should contact to voice their support that they're able to continue to use this? Should they make a comment to the EPA? What should they be doing?
Well, right now our comment period has closed on our preliminary decision, which is to re-register glyphosate. Again, not finding human health risk when used properly according to the label. And then, of course, with the ecological buffers and other restrictions that we think would be appropriate. We did hear from growers about those. We always have robust conversations about how much space we need to leave to protect, you know, to minimize those off-target impacts. We know that growers are very responsible in how they use glyphosate and all products on their farms. I mean, frankly, when I talk to growers, they emphasize that these products cost them. They are a cost. They are not wasteful with them. And they really want to use very strategic use of chemical on their products and on their crops. So what I would urge growers to do is to continue to tell their story about how environmentally responsible they are. I mean, they really are stewards of the land. I've had such a privilege in this role to meet with many growers. And for them to talk about the fact that they work the farm, they work with their father, their grandfather, their uncles, their own sons and daughters, they really are stewards. And I think that the more they tell their story about what it means to responsibly use pesticides in growing food for a hungry planet is really important. We encourage people to look at EPA as a scientific expert agency. There are a lot of sources of information on the internet, on TV, that frankly aren't science-based. We are a science-based agency. Our work is transparent. As I said, all those studies that we looked at, it's a deep dive, but if someone wanted to go through them, they could. We show our work. It's kind of like when you were in grade school and you do a math problem and your teacher would say, I don't want to know how you got the answer. I want to see how you did the work. We show our work. And we are very transparent on this matter, and we feel very confident.